An incredible time last week with the poiki competitions, and people stayed for so long afterwards. It was really, really fantastic watching all the baptisms and having communion together. What a wonderful service. And, you know, many people said maybe we should try to do that again. I think people really enjoyed it. Also, welcome back to Lee McLee. Good to see you. Good to see you, Cherise. Welcome, welcome back. These guys are not in our congregation, but they are very much part and parcel of our congregation. And so great to have you guys coming to visit. Really want to honor you guys as well. Are you guys ready for the Word of God this morning? Right, let's all stand together as I read the Word of God from Psalm chapter 6. And let's allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. O Lord, rebuke me not in your anger, nor discipline me in your wrath. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am languishing. Heal me, O Lord, for my bones are troubled. My soul is also greatly troubled. But you, O Lord, how long? Turn, O Lord, deliver my life. Save me for the sake of your steadfast love. For in death there is no remembrance of you. In Sheol, who will give you praise? I'm weary with my moaning. Every night I flood my bed with tears. I drench my couch in my weeping. My eye wastes away because of my grief. It grows weak because of all my foes. Depart from me, all you workers of evil, for the Lord has heard the sound of my weeping. The Lord has heard my plea. The Lord accepts my prayer. All my enemies shall be ashamed and greatly troubled. They shall turn back and be put to shame in a moment. Let's pray. Dear God, as we have heard your word, may your Holy Spirit speak to us, teach us, Lord, that regardless of what we face, we can turn to the living God, the Almighty, the one who delivers us from all our foes. We thank you, God, that you are with us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. You guys can grab your seats. Right, so this morning we're continuing on our series that we've entitled A Season in the Psalms, A Season in the Psalms, and we are doing six different types of psalms that we've broken up into three categories, okay? There are so many different types of psalms. Theologian David Hubbard, he said that there is a psalm for every season of life. And as we go through all the different types of psalms over the next few weeks, we want to teach you how to read the psalms more effectively for you in your devotional and in your quiet times. Right, so last week and the week before, we did what we call two psalms of orientation. Okay, the psalms of orientation, the hymns of praise and the wisdom psalms, they set us. They tell us how shall we live. They teach us more about God, and they teach us how do we relate to the Lord. Now, this week, we are starting 2 weeks where we're doing two psalms of disorientation. The psalms that help us deal with the difficult times in life, because we all sometimes go through difficult times. Life doesn't always pan out the way that we planned it. There is a famous saying by the boxer Mike Tyson in an interview, and he said, everybody's got a plan until they get punched in the mouth. And how many of you have been punched in the mouth before in life? All of us have experienced it somewhere along the line. We had these dreams or these delusions of grandeur, and suddenly things happen that we didn't plan, and all of our plans got wiped away. Sometimes our difficult times and our disorientating times can be like death by a thousand paper cuts. You know, when there's a lot of different little things in your life and all the little irritations of life come against you and they eventually take their toll. You know, my wife, some time ago, she had one of those weeks, you know, when life just conspires against you and everything starts to go wrong. And then later that afternoon, she came home and she was walking on the grass. And as she was walking the grass, she suddenly stepped and she realized she had just stepped into the dog's business. And the head just dropped. So I'm busy laughing and I'm thinking, and I say to her, Binks, is that the end of you? And she says, that's the end of me. That's the last straw. This is literally a metaphor of my life right now. So how many of you experienced that in your life before? It happens. Other times, when disorientation hits our life, it's because of either one or a few more sudden, intense, difficult traumas that come upon our lives. And it really, you get punched in the gut and all your breath gets taken out of you. A failed business. Maybe you got retrenched. A failed marriage or difficulty that you're facing in your marriage. Maybe a diagnosis physically that came as a shock to you. Or maybe the loss of a loved one. Or maybe abuse that you've suffered at the hands of somebody. Now, we need to realize that all of us will face difficulty, trials, and darkness, the season or the darkness of the soul. It happens to all of us. It's part of the human journey. And until the day that Jesus comes back to meet with us and we're going to be in glory with him, until that day, we will face trials in this life. It's part of that human experience. So how do we deal with it? How do we deal with the difficulty that comes upon our lives? And I think, James, the writer James of the epistle James, he gives us a great, some great advice on this. James chapter 1, he says, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet various trials of many kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." Now, how many of you know that is one of the favorite passages of preachers from all denominations? When people go through tough times, "Count it all joy, brother, when you go through trials of many kinds." And it is 100% true. We do need to count it all joy when we go through difficult times, because what it promises us is once the time of trial is over, we have a greater faith, a steadfast faith. We know Jesus more. There is a sanctification that's taken place in our own lives as we have grown, as we have matured. There's a certain hope that we need to have that this is exactly what the scripture says. But let's be honest. It's pretty hard to find the joy when you're right in the middle of the darkness. Am I right? It's really, really difficult. And as true as this passage is, I think when you only read this passage in isolation, you run the risk of not realizing there is a whole process of finding joy when we go through difficult times. There's a whole process that needs to take place as we try to make sense of what we are going through as we go to God. Very often people read this passage and they think somehow that we minimize or pretend that the trauma and the pain isn't there and it's not happening. And that's not healthy, and that's actually not biblical. It's actually not biblical. So how do we deal with these difficult times, and how do we find joy and count it all joy when we go through different trials of many kinds? So this morning, I'm going to be introducing a whole genre of psalms. And it is called the Psalms of Lament. The Psalms of Lament. Now, some of you have maybe read some of them. It's when they cry out to God when they are going through difficult times, just like the psalm that we just read. Some of you maybe have read the Psalms of Lament and thought, "This is depressing." Not necessarily the way that I want to wake up in the morning and read the Psalms of Lament. However, there are 150 psalms in the Bible, and about 65 of them are psalms of lament. That's more than a third. And there is a reason why more than a third of the psalms are psalms of lament, because in the human experience, we do face dark times. And how do we deal with it? And it gives us this kind of like process of how we can actually experience that. You see, a psalm of lament isn't only about crying. The Psalm of Lament is about crying out to God. In fact, when you look at most, if not all, of the lamenting psalms, I think there's one or two that don't end like that, but most of them end in what we call a statement of trust or confidence, where there is a joy and a trust that God will come through for me in this moment, and it starts to do something to the person. As they start to share their difficulty with God, by the end, He has worked in their hearts, and as they focus on Him, they start to experience a more positive attitude towards life, towards their faith, and realizing there will be a time when I'm going to overcome. There's a theologian, his name is Mark Fruchop. He's an American. I don't know how they say it there, Frugap. But actually, it's Dutch, and it means Fruchop, means waking up early. I mean, what a great name, isn't that? Mark, who wakes up early. Okay. So Mark, who wakes up early, he said the following: laments turn toward God when sorrow tempts you to run from Him. Laments turn toward God when sorrow tempts you to run from Him. Now, there are different types of psalms of lament. Some are called the penitential laments, the penitential psalms. These are psalms when you have done a great sin and you are penitent, you are broken about it, and you're going to God because the sin has really destroyed your life. It is you experience that conscience conviction that you need to go before God. You experience that separation from Him. Those are the penitential laments. Other laments, you find that they are laments of healing. Lord, I need healing in my physical body. Lord, deliver me from my enemies. There's laments about mental health and anguish and sorrow and loneliness that we go through. And many of the Psalms actually have a mixture of all of them together. You get community laments, where it's about the community lamenting. But for the most part, they are personal laments. Lord, here I am. I'm crying out to You. But of all the lamenting psalms, there are four things that they all have in common. And you're going to see it as we go through the psalm that we just read. Four things. Number one, turning to God. You are turning to God, to start off with. You bring your complaint. You ask God boldly for help. But lastly, you choose to trust God. You're going to see these four themes run through the laments. And as you read them, it's going to help you to be able to deal and process when you go through your own difficult moments. Now, I'm going to leave you with a big idea today. You're going to find it throughout this passage, and it goes as follows. By turning to God and verbalizing our struggles, He helps us through our trial, setting up an opportunity for deliverance and a growing faith. Now, we're going to turn to Psalm 6 in a moment. Psalm 6, great psalm, and what I love about it is that it's a mixture of a whole bunch of things. It's a psalm of David. We don't know when it was written in his life, but he wrote it, and he's going through quite a lot. Clearly, there is a physical healing that he's desperately needing, also a psychological healing. He's struggling physically and in his mental health. He is being chased by his own foes, and he's in desperate need of deliverance. And on top of all of that, he is also dealing with some unidentified sin that we don't know exactly what it is, but clearly there is this difficulty between him and his relationship with God because of the sin that he has committed. How many of you have ever been in a time of disorientation where it's like, I've got so many different things that I'm dealing with? And maybe that's you here today. Maybe you're like, man, you know, that's exactly how I feel. I feel like my life is just all over the place. Maybe you've dealt with that in the past. And maybe in the future, when you feel that coming upon your life, you're going to remember this sermon and you're going to have the tools how to deal with it in a biblical and a godly way. Right. So let's look at the first stanza. O Lord, rebuke me not in your anger, nor discipline me in your wrath. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am languishing. Heal me, O Lord, for my bones are troubled. My soul is also greatly troubled. But you, O Lord, how long? Now, the beautiful thing is, as difficult as David's time is in this first stanza, he's turning to God. At least that's the one thing, you know, even though in the beginning it's pretty like fractious, what he's saying and all the difficulty that he's bringing, at least the first port of call for him is to turn towards God. And David believes that probably his biggest issue is God's anger towards him because of something that he has done. Now, like I said, we don't know exactly what that is, but it seems like either there's been consequences because of the sin in his life, or maybe there's judgment from God upon him. Now, we don't know if it's the judgment of God upon him, or maybe if it's the devil trying to take him out. But what's so beautiful about when we go before God and we speak so openly to him, slowly you start to uncover God's will. You start to reveal your own heart. And as you do that, you start to find healing for your soul. Because you are going towards God. Like I said, I'm not saying it is or it isn't what David is saying. What I am trying to say is as we verbalize it, we start to hear the voice of God more clearly and we can uncover his character. And by the last stanza, you're going to see that victorious tone that starts to come through. Now, the opening two lines that we have there is a Hebrew poetic kind of device that they use. It's called parallelism. It's a bicolon. In the first psalm that we did a tricolon, three statements. This is a bicolon, two statements. The first statement is made, and the second statement makes it even stronger. So in the first statement, he says, Lord, rebuke me, not in your anger. He's saying, Lord, because of what I've done, please don't rebuke me verbally. Please don't shout at me. How many of you, don't shout at me, please. Don't rebuke me verbally. And then he goes on even stronger and he says, please, Lord, don't physically, that's what it means in the Hebrew, don't physically discipline me in your wrath. Lord, have mercy upon me. Can you sense the remorse in his life? Can you sense the depth of the sorrow of his soul as he comes before God? He doesn't know, is it God, is it the devil, well, what's going on here? But he's saying, Lord, please. He can sense the depth and that heavy weight upon him. And maybe as you're sitting here today, maybe you've been involved in sinful behavior and you can just feel in your conscience the weight of that sin upon your soul. You can sense that separation between you and God because God is a holy God. And very often, because of we feel like that, we end up running away from God. And then that rift gets even wider, and that weight of that sin gets even more. When actually, what the Lord wants from us is to turn to him. Because when we turn to him, we come to him, he washes away our sin, he forgives us, he reconciles us, and then we realize, hang on a second, exactly the opposite happened of what I thought would happen. Am I right? How many of you have ever run from God because of your sin? Hands up quickly. All the liars, put your hands up. I don't know what it is about human nature, but instead of running towards the gracious, forgiving, amazing, merciful God, we end up running away from God because of our fear. When Jesus has paid the price, we can come to him, he can wash us clean, and that's actually what he wants. When did we suddenly start to decide that God desperately desires to take us out when actually he desires to draw us closer? If you're dealing with that today, instead of running, run towards the open arms, the forgiving arms of God, your conscience will be wiped clean and the weight of the sin will be removed in your life. But it starts by turning towards God. In the next few verses, we get to the crux of the issue. We realize that he's in desperate need of healing. He says, my bones are wasting away. My bones are wasting away. He says that I need healing from this thing because I'm sorrowful in my soul. So clearly, it's not only a physical ailment that he has, but the weight of the sin, the physical ailment that he has now led him into a place of loneliness and feeling separated from God, and there's clearly a mental health issue that's starting to brew in him. For those of you that don't want to live in loneliness, let's run towards God. Let's make right with God. And more than that, let's ask God to help us. Let's ask God to heal us. And the last little verse, can we put that last little verse on again? The deepest cry, the most excruciating line, he says, but you, O Lord, how long? how long is this thing going to be upon me? How long am I going to suffer with this illness? How long am I going to be in a place where I'm not healed? Can you sense the deep cry of his heart there? How many of you have ever been that honest with God? God desires you to be honest with him about exactly what you are going through. Because the beauty of the laments is this. When we come to him and we start to verbalize honestly to God how we feel, it's actually quite cathartic for us to be able to deal with where we are at. And not only that, it starts to lead you to a place where you start to uncover God's will. Very often we ask the question, why God? Not a bad question. We'll get to that a bit later. But sometimes the Lord is wanting to teach us what he's changing in us and how he is building that steadfast hope that James spoke about, that we are counting all joy even in trials. Let's look at the next stanza. Turn, O Lord, deliver my life. Save me for the sake of your steadfast love. For in death there is no remembrance of you. In Sheol, who will give you praise? He's now starting to ask more profusely. He's turned to God and he's brought his complaints. He's going to complain a little bit later as well, but he's brought his complaints. How many of you sometimes? It's okay. That's okay. But he brings his complaint and now he's starting to ask, Lord, deliver me because of your steadfast love. Now in Hebrew, that means love, but also can be translated as loyalty. In God's steadfast loyalty, he's saying, Lord, because I am part of the covenant that you made, according to that loyalty that you have towards me, God, deliver my life. How's that for a trust statement? Lord, you have made a covenant. Lord, come through for me. And as Christians, as we stand here today, we know that Jesus Christ made a covenant of blood on that cross for us, that we can experience forgiveness. We can experience the supernatural power of God upon our lives as the Holy Spirit resides in us. God has made a covenant with you to give you eternal life, but also not only that, to help you through to deal with the difficulties of life as well. Lord, according to the loyalty of your covenant as your son and as your daughter, I come to you, and according to your steadfast loyalty and love, God, I cry out to you. How powerful is that? How many of you ever prayed like that? That you stand on God's word. That you're calling our trust in him. David goes even further. He says, but Lord, the Old Testament saints didn't have a very advanced understanding of the afterlife. Okay, so David, in writing here, he calls it Sheol, the place where the dead go. And basically, you die and then you just kind of there. There's no afterlife or connection with God in the afterlife. So in his understanding, he's saying, Lord, if I die, who's going to praise you? Saying, Lord, in your best interests, it's for you to heal me. Because otherwise, there'll be no one to pray. I can't praise you when I'm dead. So Lord, it's going to be so futile and pointless if I die. So Lord, please heal me. I mean, how honest is this guy? But you know, I think there's actually a deeper thing that he's asking the Lord. In some way, he's saying, Lord, how pointless would it be when I die? How many of you sometimes think that your suffering just seems so pointless? Futile. But Lord, why? Why, God? Why is not a bad question sometimes to ask in this process of lamenting well? You know, as a Christian, we need to learn to lament well. It's going to help you. Lord, why is this happening to me? It's not wrong to ask that. But as you ask that, you need to trust that the Holy Spirit's going to start to reveal to you sometimes what is God's will in this situation. But secondly, not only to reveal his will, but there's going to be a certain element of faith that rises inside of you to be able to deal with it. Because by the end, like I said, there is a change in mood that we'll see in the last stanza. Right, let's get to some more complaining. Are you guys ready? Okay, verse 6. I am weary with my moaning. Every night I flood my bed with tears. I drench my couch with my weeping. My eye wastes away because of my grief. It grows weak because of all my foes. Clearly, he's got great anguish. He's cried so much. He's cried so much that he can no longer see. That's how many tears he has in his eyes. My eye wastes away. My eye becomes dim because of all my tears that I've been crying. You can tell he's going through an incredible trauma in this time. And now he reveals to us for the first time, it's not only the sin, it's not only the healing that he's desperately needing, but there are enemies at the gates. We don't know, like I said, the date of the psalm. It's not dated, so we don't know exactly when in David's life this has actually happened. But what we do know is this: there are enemies hunting him down, enemies coming against him, and it's taken away his joy. He's struggling terribly. How do I deal with this? Now, for many of us here, many of you might have physical, you know, human enemies in your life, and it is what it is. These things do happen. We live in a fallen and evil world. But I do want to give us some advice on that. Ephesians chapter 6 tells us that our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and the principalities of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, when we come against somebody with flesh and blood who is an enemy or coming against you, we need to kind of appreciate there is a spirit behind them that is pushing them into this direction. And when you start to see that, you find more grace for them, you're able to forgive more easily, and you start to fight the battle in the right place. Instead of fighting the person, you start to fight the spirit behind it. That's why prayer is so important. That's why our victory groups are so important. Get together, pray for one another, that we can see perspective and we can attack the enemy of our soul, which is the devil himself. So that's just something to put out there. But now notice how the mood changes in the last stanza. He has come to Jesus. He's turned to look to the Lord. He has brought his complaints. He has asked God boldly to deliver him, to heal him. But here we find in verse 8, "Depart from me, all you workers of evil, for the Lord has heard the sound of my weeping. The Lord has heard my plea. The Lord accepts my prayer. All my enemies shall be ashamed and greatly troubled, and they shall turn back and be put to shame in a moment." This is a typical lament psalm where it ends with what we call a confidence statement, a trust statement in the goodness and the glory and the power of God, that God will deliver him. He will deliver him. Notice he is choosing to trust God, and as he chooses to trust God, if there was a physical ailment, he trusts that God will heal him. If there was a sin, he trusts that he'll be forgiven. If there is an enemy, he believes that they will be vanquished. Now, I don't know what you are facing today. Maybe you're reading this and you're like, listen, this is exactly where I am at. But as we start to read through this lament, joy starts to seep back into David's life because he knows this: I can count it all joy. I can now count it all joy because I know that God is with me. I can count it all joy because I know that my enemies will be defeated. And whatever you are going through today, to know this, the enemy, the devil, is going to rue the day that he came to try and take out your life. Because when he tried to destroy your life and he brought darkness upon your path, what you did was, instead of running away from God, you ran towards God, into the loving arms of God. You experienced forgiveness and healing and deliverance. And at the end of it, you became stronger, more resilient, more faith, more understanding of who God is. And now the devil, even if he throws bigger things at you, you're going to handle that as well. Notice how important these laments are. And as you read these lamenting psalms in times of difficulty in your quiet times, I really trust that you're going to learn and have the ability to start to write your own laments to the Lord as well. Start to write your own. Lord, here I am. This is what I'm dealing with. And in that, you are being given a great tool to be able to deal with the darkness and the difficult times in our lives. Let me remind you of the big idea. By turning to God and verbalizing our struggles, He helps us through our trial, setting up an opportunity for deliverance and a growing faith. Now I'm going to close with this. Often people think that God doesn't understand my struggles. People think that God is up there. I remember there was a song that you became quite famous, even in Christian circles, I don't know why. It was called From a Distance. You guys remember that song? And all the Christians, from a distance. But when you read the lyrics, it's saying that God is watching us from a distance, that He is not involved in human affairs. And from a distance, everything looks hunky-dory. He doesn't know what's going on. How scary is that? I want to tell you that our God is not watching us from a distance. He is involved in our lives intimately. So much so that God sent His own Son to suffer as a human being here on earth so that our God cannot say He does not understand suffering. He certainly does. He lived it. He lived it. And as we go on, you realize that even Jesus lamented before the Father. In the Garden of Gethsemane, just before He's about to get arrested and then go on to that great ordeal to face the cross, He cries out and He says this in Matthew 26. Then He said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even unto death. Remain here and watch with me." And going a little farther, He fell on His face and prayed, saying, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as You will." On this moment where He's about to embark on that great battle with the great enemy of our souls, when He would be crucified on that cross, He cries out to the Lord. He turns to His Father. He brings His complaint before the Lord. Sorrowful, even unto death. He then eventually comes and He says, "Lord, take this cup away from me." He comes and He asks. But His trust statement says, "Lord, but Your will be done, not mine." How powerful is that? Sometimes we don't understand why we go, what we are going through. But what we can know is this: our God understands what we are going through. He understands. And not only does He understand, He is with us. And one day when we meet again with Him, because He died on that cross, He defeated sorrow, He defeated loneliness, He defeated sin, we'll be with Him for eternity. There'll be no more tears, no more difficulty. Amen. But until that day, while we are still here on this earth, I do want to say this. The Holy Spirit lives in us. And the same power that raised Christ from the dead empowers us to be able to deal with the pain and the difficulties of life. Let's learn to lament well. Because a good lament is turning towards Him and ultimately growing in our trust.